इज द स्क्रीन विजिबल स्टूडेंट्स? स्क्रीन इज विजिबल?
यस सर।
ओके, वील कंटिन्यू विद द सेकेंड हाफ ऑफ थर्ड मॉड्यूल, राइट? इट इज प्रोग्राम कंट्रोल इंस्ट्रक्शंस. Program control, as the name itself indicates, that it is meant to control the sequence of program execution. The sequence in which the program is executed is controlled, and that is what is called as the program control instruction or the program control instructions. That means that these instructions, they are either used to jump from one instruction to another instruction, or they are used to bypass certain instructions when jumping from one instruction to some other instruction, or they are meant to enable or disable a block of logic program, a block of logic program. All this is done by the program control instructions. And the first one that we are going to study under the program control instructions is the master control reset instruction. This master control reset instruction, it is meant to reset or disable certain logic rungs when it is de-energized. When it is energized, it will perform normal function. It will perform normal function. That is, all the rungs will be performing normal function. But when the master control reset instruction is de-energized, or the other rungs in the program will be de-energized, except those which are with the retained instructions. That is, retentive instructions, only those will be having the state of the previous one. All the other instructions, all the other ladder rungs will be de-energized when the master control reset instruction is de-energized. That means it is used to reset or disable certain portion or certain zone of the ladder logic program. Okay. Several output type instructions, which are often referred to as override instructions. There are certain instructions which are called override instructions. These are meant to provide a means of executing sections of the control logic if certain conditions are met. It is as good as your if-else statement. If-else statement in C program. If condition is true, execute this. If condition is false, then execute this. Right? So if the condition is met, only certain portion of the program is executed. If the condition is not met, then that particular program portion will not be executed. Portions of the program not being utilized at any particular time can be jumped over. We can jump from certain portion of the program to some other instruction, and outputs in specific zones in the program can be left in the desired states. That means when the program jumps from one instruction to some other instruction, right, the in-between program will be bypassed, and the output of the in-between instructions will be left in their original states. Right? It will be left in their desired or their original states. Program control instructions are used to enable or disable a certain block of logic program, or to move the execution of a program from one place to another place. So such of the instructions are called program control instructions. The next figure shows the program control menu tab for the Allen Bradley SLC 500 PLC. This subject is mainly concentrating on the Allen Bradley SLC 500 PLC and RS Logix software. The name of the PLC is called as Allen Bradley SLC 500 PLC, and the name of the software is SLC RS Logix software. Here, for the Allen Bradley, there is a menu tab. Let us see the menu tab. This is the menu tab of the Allen Bradley SLC 500 PLC. And in this menu tab, here we can see the various instructions. JMP stands for jump, then LBL stands for label, JSR is jump subroutine, RET is return, and this is subroutine SBR, then this is temporary end instruction, then this is MCR, master control reset instruction, and SUS, suspend instruction. These are the various program control instructions that we are seeing here on the menu tab of the, that is, Allen Bradley SLC 500 controller or the PLC. The different commands, that is different instructions, are as follows. JMP, jump to label, that is this JMP instruction will make a jump from one instruction to some other instruction, right? Say there are about 5 rungs in the program. There may be a jump from first rung to fourth rung. In between second and third rung may be bypassed. This is called a jumping, right? When there is a jump from one instruction to another instruction or from one rung to another rung, the in-between instructions, the in-between rung will be bypassed. Okay, that is what is the called as the jump instruction. And this jump can be forward jump or backward jump. Forward jump means jumping in the forward direction. If you are written a program, say from the first rung, second rung, third rung, fourth, fifth, and so on, there is a jump, say from first rung to fourth rung, right? This is called as forward jump. If there is a jump from fourth rung back to first rung, this is called as backward jump. If there is a jump of the instructions from the fourth rung instruction to the instruction which is present in the first rung, it is called as backward jump. There are two types of jump. One is the forward jump, another one is the backward jump. Okay, you all have to remember these instructions, right? Jump forward or backward took a corresponding label instruction. Then label, we are saying that there is a jump from one instruction to some other instruction, from first rung instruction to fourth rung instruction. When there is a jump, then how we'll come to know that where the jump should take place? Now say there is a first rung, right? I'm using the jump instruction. Where it should jump? Simply, if I use the jump instruction, where it should jump? Whether it should jump to second rung or third rung or fifth rung, which rung has to jump? That is decided by the label. That is decided by the label. When we use a label in the instruction, jump instruction, it means that the jump will take place to that particular rung which has that particular label. Now say I use the jump JMP Q2:0. Q2:0 is the label which is given to the fourth rung. Let us say that first rung, I'm using the instruction JMP Q2:0. That means it will jump to the fourth rung because the address of the fourth rung is Q2:0. Right, I'm specifying the label or the address to which the jump should take place. That is called as the destination address or the target address. That is, the jump should take place to which instruction, to which rung, to which label. Okay, or a label. Clear here? LBL label specifies the label location. Then JSR, jump to subroutine. This will jump to a designated subroutine instruction. JSR, this is jump to label. It will jump to a particular label, that is instruction which has a particular label. Then JSR, it will jump to the particular subroutine. This is meant to jump from one instruction to another instruction, JMP and LBL. But if you are using subroutine is set of instructions to perform a specific function. Like how you are writing a function in C program. You are writing a function, say, to add two numbers in the C language. Right? That function is executed repeatedly. As you are calling that function, it will execute repeatedly. I will input the numbers to that function. Correct? It will provide the output and the output will return back to the main program. Similarly, the subroutine is a set of instructions that is executed more than one time, repeatedly. Executing such instructions or set of instructions are called as subroutine. The JSR instruction is particularly meant for you have to make use of JSR or the jump to subroutine instruction. Jump to a designated subroutine instruction. Then RET, return from subroutine. There is a jump from one instruction to another instruction or from one subroutine, main program to the subroutine, right? Main program, you're writing the main instructions, that is printf, scanf, like how you write in the C language. right? Similarly, here we will be writing the main program. Then the subroutine, it consists of set of instructions which are meant to perform a particular function, a particular application. After executing the subroutine, we are using return instruction. That means now the control should return back to the next instruction in the main program. That means it will not return back to the jump instruction. Jump instruction has already executed. After the jump instruction has executed, it will jump to the subroutine, bypassing the in-between instructions, skipping the in-between instructions. After it jumps to the subroutine, it will execute the subroutine instructions. After executing all the subroutine instructions, it will execute the return instruction. Return means where it should return. It will return to the next instruction after the jump instruction. It will return to the next instruction after the jump instruction in the main program. Okay, this is the function of the RET, return from subroutine. Exits current subroutine and returns to previous condition. SBR subroutine, it identifies the subroutine program. SBR means it is meant to recognize or identify the particular subroutine. For that, we are using the SBR instruction, which is subroutine instruction. It is an identifier or the identification of the subroutine, which subroutine it has to jump. Suppose we are using JSR, right? Jump to subroutine. Then it goes to that particular subroutine, which is with the particular identification SBR. It will execute that subroutine. After it executes the subroutine, the last instruction is RET always, return. It will return back to the next instruction after the jump instruction. Okay, so that is how it executes here. This is the SBR or the subroutine, which identifies the subroutine program. Then TND, temporary end. This makes a temporary end that halts the program execution. TND means temporary end instruction. It temporarily halts the program execution. Okay, it's a temporary end which halts the program execution. Program execution stops, then we can perform the checking of the output that can be done. Then master when I was introducing about master control instruction, the master control instruction. Value, then it is called as retentive type. Okay. Master control reset clears all the non-retentive output runs. That means the rung which in which the accumulated value becomes zero if power supply is off, such rung accumulated value will be made equal to zero with the execution of MCR instruction. That instruction. And the last instruction in this series is SUS. right? Then it is provided. I mean, okay, so there is some network problem. So did you understand, dear students? I was explaining about the instructions, conditional program control instructions. You understood these instructions now? JMP, jump to label, LBL, jump to subroutine, RET, SBR, TND, temporary end, MCR, master control reset, and SUS, suspend instruction. Do you all understand these instructions, or should I explain once again? Yes, please. Did you all understand these instructions, or should I explain them once again? Mudabbira?
Yes, sir.
Did you all understand or understood, or should I explain once again these instructions? Inoj?
Sir, you were not audible last time.
I
was not audible. Okay, I will explain them once again then. Okay, there was some network problem. I will explain one. Okay. The first instruction in the program control instructions is JMP, jump to label. There are two types of jump. In between there is a problem. Just let me know, please. Okay.
Sir, the
JMP, jump to label. Screen is not visible. Okay. One minute, just I'll check. No, it is already, video is unmuted. You are not seeing my face? Presentation is not able
to see. So you can see your face, but you cannot see the screen. Presenting.
Screen, presentation you are not able to see. 1 minute, I'll just check. Okay, I think it has been disabled. 1 minute, I'll enable it once again. Now you can see, students. Are you able to see now?
Yes, sir.
Inoj? Okay, right. Here, there are different program control instructions. The first one is JMP, jump to label. This is jump forward or backward jump. Right? Let us say there are 5 rungs in the ladder rung program. And I want to jump from first rung to fourth rung. I can do that. Right, by bypassing the or skipping the in between second and third rung instructions. This is called as forward jump. Similarly, I can jump from fourth rung back to the first rung. It is called backward jump, from fourth rung back to the first rung. Okay, these are the two types of jump. Remember, one is forward jump, another one is backward jump. Then there is LBL, label instruction, which specifies label location. I am jumping from first instruction. Now, when I use the JMP instruction, how to come to know that to which instruction I have to jump or to which rung the jump should take place? That is identified by the LBL, that is the label. Label is which identifies to which location the jump should take place. Right? For example, you are placing the label on your notebook. Right? You have the label, you stick up that on your notebook. Right? What it identifies? It identifies the that it is so and so person, okay, with so and so designation, that is identified by the label. Similarly, label means whenever we specify the label in the jump instruction, it jumps to that particular rung which is having that label. I use the instruction JMP Q2:0. Q2:0. Let us say the address Q2:0 is for the fourth rung. That means the jumps will take place from the first rung to the fourth rung. The fourth rung has the address Q2:0. Okay. This is called as the label LBL. Then JSR, jump to subroutine. It jumps to a particular subroutine instruction, designated subroutine instruction, JSR. Subroutine is a set of instructions which are executed more than one time. It is just like the function that you use in your C program. The function you are calling, whenever you require, say, to add two numbers, you are calling it repeatedly. You input the numbers, you call it, get the addition, and the result or the addition of two numbers will be returned back to the main program. Okay, this is called as the function in C language. In the PLC language, it is called as the subroutine. Subroutine are the set of instructions which are repeatedly executed more than one time to perform a particular function. Okay. Then RET, return from subroutine. The program jumps from the main program. If the control jumps from the main program to the subroutine, at the end of the subroutine, there is a RET instruction, return. Always the last instruction in the subroutine is the RET instruction or the return instruction. This return instruction will return the control back to the next instruction in the main program, which is the instruction from where the jump has taken place, JMP. The next instruction after JMP, that will be started executing from there in the main program once the RET instruction is executed. We'll see those in the figures. Next, I'll be showing you all the figures. You'll come to know clearly what is the function of each of these instructions. Then SBR, subroutine. It identifies the subroutine program. There is JSR instruction, jump to subroutine. SBR, subroutine instruction, which identifies the subroutine. Okay. And the return instruction, which from where the return will take place from the subroutine back to the main program. So we have JSR, jump to subroutine, SBR, subroutine, which identifies the subroutine, and the return instruction which returns the, that is from the subroutine to the main program. Okay. TND, temporary end. This makes a temporary end that halts the program execution. There's a temporary stopping of the program. Once the program stops, we can check for the output of the program. MCR, master control reset. As I told in the beginning, master control reset is for resetting the other rung instructions whenever MCR instruction is disabled. Whenever MCR instruction is de-energized, right, that time the other rung instructions will also be de-energized, except the retentive instructions. Retentive instructions are the instructions in which the accumulated value remains at that particular value wherever it was, even after the power supply is turned off. Suppose say the preset value is say 10, accumulated value is 0, it will start accumulating. Accumulated value start to increase 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up till 10. Suppose the accumulated value is 5 and the power supply goes off. When the power supply goes off, the accumulated value will become 0. Such of the instructions are called non-retentive instructions. In the retentive instructions, what will happen? If the accumulated value is 5, after the power supply is turned off and the power supply returns back, the accumulated value remains as 5. So such of the instructions are called retentive instructions. Okay. Clears all set non-retentive output rungs. This is the MCR or the master control reset. Then SUS suspend. This identifies conditions for debugging and system troubleshooting. Once it executes SUS or the suspend instruction, after executing the SUS instruction, the programmer can debug the errors, right? He can troubleshoot, remove the errors. That is possible once the SUS or the suspend instruction is executed, right? Clear, clear, students. I hope you understood this. Okay, this topic. Okay. So this is a program control menu tab, as I showed you all, JM. LP jump, LBL label, JSR jump. Subroutine RET return, SBR subroutine, TND temporary end, M instruction. Now these instructions are not hardwired. Hardwired means it is actual circuit. The hardware, that is what meaning of hardwired. If it is a circuit, turn off the power of the entire circuit, that is called as a hardwired master control based circuit. There are instructions which we can use in the program as the hardwired master control relay instructions. So such of the instructions are called programmed master control relay instructions. Hardwired instructions means they are the hardware, they are the actual circuit components, right? The relay circuit which is used to reset the entire circuit. Whereas if it is the relay that is used in the program, it is the instruction that we are using, and that instruction we are calling it as programmed master control relay instruction. A master control reset instruction is an output call instruction that functions like a master control relay. MCR or a master control reset instruction, it is a output instruction that functions similar to a hardwired master control relay instruction. MCR call instructions are used in PES. Whenever we are using a master control instruction, we are using two MCR instructions. It is as good as using a two MCR instruction. One in MCR we are using at the beginning, and another one we are using at the ending. One at the starting, another one at the end. So it is a double MCR instruction. It is used in pairs and can be programmed to control an entire circuit or to control only selected runs of a circuit. Either the MCR instruction is used to control the entire program or certain portion of the program, certain runs of the program. Okay, that is the function of the MCR control instructions. Let us now go through a program wherein the MCR is programmed to control an entire circuit. The operation of the program can be summarized like this. Let us go through the program. This is our program here on the master control reset instruction. Initially, let us say that this on or off, it is closed position. On off, this is a selector switch. It is closed position, it is on. It is examine if closed, it is true. MCR instruction will be true. It is energized, right? When it is energized, then stop is examine if closed. This is true. Start instruction, this will become closed. This is true, right? And the motor will be energized. M will be energized. This is seal in contact M to conduct the current even after the start switch has been released. This is seal in contact. Then level switch. This is a level switch. Here it is. It is already in closed position. So it is true. The pilot light will be turned on. PL1 will be turned on. Then we have the level switch, LS. The level switch, this is also a normally closed condition. It is true. So the solenoid will be activated. Solenoid valve will be energized or it is activated. Okay, this is a latch solenoid valve where the previous state, whatever it has obtained, that will be latched. Okay, suppose say the solenoid valve condition is 1, its status is 1. That 1 will be retained for the next time span. Okay, for the next conditions, it will be retained or it will be latched. The meaning of latch is, it is whatever is the status or the condition of the solenoid valve that will remain after some time, even after the switch has been disabled. Okay, that is the meaning of latching. Then we have one more latch, LS2. When this is closed, it is already in closed position. So examine if closed is true, it will activate the unlatch coil solenoid. Solenoid unlatch. Solenoid unlatch, this is doing the opposite function as that of the latching. Solenoid unlatch means whatever was the previous state before latching, that will be the position. Okay. Now say latching means it will retain the position. Unlatch means whatever is the present status, that it will consider, not the latching condition. Okay, present status, if it is 1, energized, then it will be 1. Present status, if it is 0, de-energized, it will be 0. Right? So whatever is the present status, that will be retained. That is the meaning of unlatch. Latch means whatever was the previous state that will be continued, okay, for some span of time. That is the meaning of latching. Then here we have one MCR at the beginning, one MCR at the end. This is the zone in which the MCR operates, from this MCR to this MCR. It is called as a zone. It is one zone we call. Now let us consider for the second condition. The selector switch is de-energized. It is opened. When it is opened, on-off condition is false. Right? This will become false and the MCR coil will be de-energized. Master control reset will be de-energized. When master control relay coil will be reset, instruction is de-energized. That time what will happen? Accordingly, the rung which are below the MCR, the rung which are below the MCR, those will be de-energized. Except those which are retentive in nature. That means this will be de-energized. This will be de-energized. It is showing here, when MCR is de-energized, all non-retentive outputs will de-energize. This M will be de-energized. This level switch pilot light PL1 will be de-energized. It will be turned off. Right? And then this is latch and this is unlatch. They are the latch instructions. They will be retaining the previous output. They will be retaining the previous output. Because they are retentive in nature, they retain the previous condition or the previous state, whatever was there, that will be continued. Okay, for these retentive type instructions. So such is the execution of the MCR instruction. If in examination, if they ask, explain the master control reset instruction or explain the program control instructions, you will have to explain these program control instructions, the JMP, LBL, all these instructions. And then if they ask the hardwired master control relay instruction or the master control reset instruction, then you will have to draw this diagram, ladder rung, and you will have to explain the usage or the working of the master control reset instruction. Okay. This is how it operates. When it is energized, normal function. It is a normal function when it is in energized condition. All the rungs will execute as they are. Okay. When the MCR instruction is de-energized, that time what will happen? The rungs which are below the MCR instruction, those will also be de-energized, except the rungs which are retentive in nature. Except those other rungs will be de-energized. Right? Allen Bradley SLC 500 controllers use the master control reset instruction to set up single or multiple zones within a program. Allen Bradley SLC 500 controller use the master control reset instruction to set up single zone or multiple zones within the program. As I told here, this is one zone. From this MCR to this MCR, it is one zone. Similarly, we can have many number of zones. Many number of zones, which is called as multiple zones. There's a single, then it is a one zone, then it is called a single zone. If there are more than one zones, it is called as multiple zones. Okay. Allen Bradley SLC 500 controllers use the master control reset instruction to set up single or multiple zones within a program. The MCR instruction is used in pairs, disable or enable a zone within a ladder program and it has no address. The MCR instruction either enables a zone or disables a zone. That means it is turning off the non-retentive instructions. It is resetting the non-retentive instructions or de-energizing the non-retentive instructions, except the instructions which are retentive in nature. Within a ladder program and this has no address. The zone in which the MCR instruction operates has no address. Okay. MCR controlled areas must contain only two MCR instructions, one to define the start and one to define the end. So this MCR instruction, one is used at the beginning, another one is used at the end. So it is a pair of MCR instruction. When we say master control reset instruction, it is always used in pair. One at the starting, another one at the end. Okay. This is one more program which is MCR fenced zone with the zone true. That means this is called as the starting instruction to the end instruction. MCR starting, it is called a start fence. Then the MCR end, it is called as the end fence. Fine. So I think there is no doubts in this program, friends, here. Are there any doubts in this program? I hope everyone understood this master control reset instruction. Students, Inoj?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In this program, as we can see, there is one instruction MCR at the beginning, which is called start fence. Another instruction MCR at the end, which is called as the end fence. The pair of MCR instructions, one at the start called as the start fence, another one at the end called as the end fence. Right? Then here, when this is energized, right? When this is energized, it operates in a normal way. Whatever is the condition of that trunk, whatever is the condition of the input and output, that will be as it is. But when the instruction is de-energized, the MCR instruction is de-energized, that time the rungs which are below the MCR instruction, they will also be de-energized, but only the non-retentive retentive instructions will not be de-energized. Okay, that is the condition. Now here input A is true, so when this is closed, MCR instruction, this is active or it is energized, then the condition of the other rungs will be as they are. Input B is energized, so output A, this will be in on state. Input C is also energized. When it is pressed, the timer will be turned on. The accumulated value goes from 0 to 10. Done bit will become equal to 1, and output B will also be energized here. For the input D switched here, the latch coil will be energized and the output B will be turned on. Then when we are pressing the input E switch, this is the limit switch. When it is pressed, then this will be closed and the unlatch output B, this will also be energized. Then the last instruction is the MCR, which is used in pair, one at the starting, another one at the end. This is called as fence or the zone. Let us now analyze for the other condition, that is when the input A is de-energized. When the input A is de-energized, that means when input A is off, there's the next one you can see here. Input C. Input C, it is also turned off, that it is not retentive timer, it is just a normal timer. It is also turned off. Enable will become zero here. Then what is the reason? Mudabir?
Sir, you were not audible. Can you ask again?
Are you all here, students?
Sir, you are not audible. Actually.
Are you here? Okay, fine. Now I am clear, no? I am audible right now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Now, what I am asking is, so input A it is, now it is,
sir, you're not audible, it's breaking in between.
Energized. When this is energized, the below rungs, the rungs which are below CFCR will also be energized, which are those will also be disabled because it is not a retentive timer. This will be disabled. Therefore, enable will become zero here. This enable.
Sir, your voice is breaking.
In there is some network problem. Okay. So this concept is clear, right? Master control set with the zone. The concept is clear here. Enoch. Enoch. Enoch D'Souza.
Screen is not visible, sir.
Screen is not visible again. Okay. 1 minute.
So I think you have a network issue, your side.
Okay. Screen is visible now, friends. Screen is visible now. Yes. Saval,
yes sir, screen is visible.
Okay. Okay, so you understood the concept of MCR with the zone here. The concept is clear. Master control reset with the zone. What is meant by zone? In that, that is a region in which the start MCR and end MCR are used, and in between those regions, when the MCR instruction is de-energized, the instructions which are below the MCR instructions are de-energized, right? Except the instructions which are retentive. Except those, all the other instructions will be de-energized. Okay. I hope the concept is clear here. Yes, please. Inoj, concept is clear?
No, sir. Slightly. Again, you revise, sir.
Okay. Okay. I will come to that. Once again, I will explain this as a zone for false condition. Then it will be clear to you. Okay. Now, true condition means what? When the input A is true, right? Here it will be energized. Energized means as it is, right? Just remember that. What all are the conditions of the input or output, whatever it is, it will be as it is. Okay. That is what is meant by energized condition, or the energized condition of the MCR, master control reset instruction. Then when it is de-energized condition, that is the input A is released. When input A is released, this input A, this exam if closed becomes false. When this becomes false, MCR instruction will be de-energized. MCR instruction will be de-energized. When this is de-energized, then the rung which are below the MCR, the rung which are below the MCR, they will also be de-energized. That is output A. First it was on state because input B was switched here, it was closed, output A was on. Now when it is de-energized, output A will also be de-energized, it will go to off state. Timer will also be de-energized because it is not retentive timer. Its enable bit will become zero. Then input D. Input D, this is connected to the latch. It is a latch. And as it is a latch, it is retentive. Latch means it will retain the previous state. Okay. So that is why output B will be still in on state. It will be in the on state. It will not be in off state. Previously also it was on output B. Then next, when the MCR is de-energized, that time also it will be in the on state. Then input E, this is unlatch output B. This will also remain in the previous state. And input E, then last one is the MCR, that is the end fence. Okay. So this is from the start fence to the end fence. One MCR is used at the starting, another MCR at the end. And this is called as the one zone of the MCR instruction. One zone. Right? Now it is clear here to everyone. Is it clear to everyone? This MCR. Inoj? Inoj?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll proceed further. Next is simple jump instruction. As I told, the jump instruction will jump from one instruction to some other instruction. As it jumps from one instruction to some other instruction, the in-between instructions will be skipped. And some of the manufacturers, they use skip instruction instead of the jump instruction, which is same as the jump instruction. The jump instruction is an output instruction used for the purpose of jumping from one instruction to some other instruction when certain conditions are satisfied. When the jump instruction is used, the PLC will not execute the instructions of a rung that is jumped. That means when it jumps from one instruction to the other instruction, the in-between instructions will not be executed. They will be having the states, the condition or the status will remain of these instructions as in the previous condition. Okay. The jump instruction is often used to jump over instructions not pertinent to the machine's operation at that instant. It is often used to jump from one instruction to some other instructions. In addition, sections of a program may be programmed to be jumped should a production fault occur. Now, why the jump instruction should be used in industry? In industry, jump instructions are used so that if there is any fault occurring, there is a jump from that instruction to some other instruction to overcome the fault. Right? To rectify the fault, there is jump from the normal program execution to some other instruction to so as to rectify the fault occurring in the system. Okay. Some manufacturers use skip. instruction, which is same as a jump instruction. The next figure shows the use of a jump instruction. In the Allen Bradley SLC 500 PLC, this is PB switch. PB switch, right? When PB switch is pressed, what's PB switch? When this PB switch is pressed, what happens to PL1, PL2, and PL3? Yes, anyone? When PB is switched, pressed, PL1 will be on. PL2 is also on because it is in press state. Examine closed. PB is also closed, PL2 will be on, PB is also closed, same PB, PL3 will also be in on state. PL1, PL2 and PL3, all the three will be in the on state when PB is pressed and still switch is not closed. Next, what I am doing, so PL1, PL2, PL3, all the three lamp will glow. Next, what I am doing, I am pressing the switch. As I press this switch and PB is also pressed, and as I press this switch, this jump instruction is executed. What is the address of the label? Q2:0. That means Q2:0 is here. It will skip this third rung and direct it will jump from second rung to fourth rung. It will jump from second rung to fourth rung where it will execute the PL3. So PL2 is not executed. It is skipped when the jump instruction JMP is executed. Okay. So as it jumps from the second rung to the third rung, okay, there is the execution of the jump instruction by skipping over the third rung. Okay. That is what it is. The label instruction is a target for the jump instruction. The jump instruction with this associated label will have the same address. This is the jump instruction. As you can see, it is address. Its address is Q2:0. The address of the LBL is also Q2:0. The area of the program that the processor jumps is defined by locations of the jump and the label instructions of the program. What is the area of the jump? That is decided by the region in between the jump instruction and the label instruction. If the jump coil is energized, all logic between the jump and label instructions is bypassed and the processor continues scanning after the LBL instruction. So this program is clear here, students. I'll explain the operation of this once again. The switch is open, the jump instruction is not activated. When switch open, closing PB turns all three pilot lights. When this PB is pressed, PL1, PL2, PL3 are turned on. When switch is closed, JMP instruction will activate. When this switch is closed, this is closed, true condition, this jump instruction will be activated. When the switch closed, pressing PB turns on pilot light PL1 and PL3 only. Note that when we press the switch, there is a jump instruction. So PL1 has already turned on. Now when this jump instruction is executed, PL2 is skipped. The third rung is skipped. Directly will jump from second rung to fourth rung. So PL1 and PL3 will be turned on only. And PL2 will not be turned on because it is skipped. Rung 3 is skipped over during the PLC program scan. So PL2 is not turned on. Clear here? Is this clear, students? This jump instruction? Jump instruction is clear to everyone? This one, whatever we studied here. This is clear, execution of jump instruction. In examination, they may ask, explain the working of the jump operation or explain the working of the jump instruction. Then you are supposed to draw this figure and then explain how it works. Right? Saval, is it clear? This instruction? Saval?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next, jump to label from two locations. There is one label here, Q2:5. There is a jump from this to this, right? There is one more label here. The same label, the jump is taking place from the jump instruction, which is in the first, second, third, fourth rung. There is one jump instruction in the first rung. It will jump from this rung to the last rung. There is one more jump instruction in the fourth rung. It will jump from the fourth rung to the last rung. Okay. So like this, their jump will take place. Right. Now you need not bother what are there in between. If you want to explain this, particularly this concept of the jump instruction, where the multiple jump is taking place to the same label, then whatever are there here, you can use them according to your will and wish, need not be same as it is in this figure. Okay, because the concept is important. What we want to highlight here is the concept. What is the concept? The jump from this rung, first rung, it is having the address Q2:5. It jumps to the same label. Thus, rung in the fourth rung, which is having one more jump instruction, its label is also same. That is Q2:5. It is also jumping to the same label. Okay. Next, subroutine functions. I told you all already what is a subroutine. What is a subroutine? Can anybody define a subroutine? How do you define a subroutine? Definition of subroutine. Can anybody define it? And I even gave the comparison between subroutine and functions in C language. What is a subroutine?
A set of program, yes, from the main program.
Yes, correct. It is a set of instructions, okay, which are executed more than one time. Simple definition, right? A subroutine is a set of instructions which are executed more than one time. So such of the instructions are called subroutine. Okay. A subroutine is a short program that is used by the main program to perform a specific function. What is the main job of the subroutine? To perform a particular application, a particular function. Large programs are broken into smaller subroutines. There's a large program. This large program is broken down into many subroutines. By breaking down into many subroutines, the program becomes simple to analyze. Debugging becomes easier. Program execution will become fast. Right, all these advantages are there by using the subroutines. Okay, if you are writing a large program, all the instruction set are stretch, then what will happen? It is very difficult to debug the errors, right? And then it is very difficult to analyze the program. So all those difficulties are there, disadvantages. But if you all use the subroutines in the program, that is, if you break down your large program into many smaller programs with the main program, then that is having many advantages. Large programs are often broken into subroutine program files, which are called and executed from the main program. Use of a subroutine is a valuable tool in PLC programming. At times, it is better to construct programs that consist of several subroutines than a lengthy single program. Instead of writing a lengthy single program, it is better to write many subroutines. Break down the large program into smaller subroutines. When programs are written with subroutines, each subroutine can be tested individually for the functionality. We can debug each of these subroutines separately. These subroutines can then be called from the main program as illustrated in the next figure. Okay. This is the figure which shows how the subroutine execute. Okay, there is a main program here. This is our main program. These are the rungs, main program rungs, and somewhere in between the condition is true and JSR jump subroutine instruction is executed, it will jump to the subroutine. This is the area here, subroutine area, it will jump to this. As it executes the subroutine instruction, executes all the instructions, the last instruction in the subroutine is RET. Return instruction, short form of return instruction is RET. Once it executes the return instruction, then it will return the control, it will return back to the next instruction in the main program. It is thus a concept is similar to the functions in C language, right? In the main program, you call the function will execute. At the end of the function, what will happen? It will return back to the next instruction in the main program. The same concept is for the subroutines. What all concept you have studied for the functions in C language, same concept applies for the subroutines in PLC language. This is how it executes here. This figure is clear here, students. This figure is clear to everyone. Any doubts in this figure? Everyone understood this? Haldankar Pratik Jitendra? Haldankar Pratik Jitendra, is it understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When a subroutine is called from the main program, the program is able to escape from the main program and go to a program subroutine to perform certain functions and then return to the main program. This is the job of the subroutine or the function of subroutine. The subroutine concept is the same for all PLCs. The concept of subroutine remains the same for all the PLCs, but which instructions are used to jump or to return, those will differ from one manufacturer to another manufacturer. Concept remains the same, but the instructions which are used for jump or for the return, they will change from one manufacturer to another manufacturer. The subroutine related instructions used in the Allen Bradley PLCs shown in the next figure are JSR, that is jump to subroutine, which is an output instruction, SBR subroutine, which is an input instruction, and a return, that is RET, which is an output instruction. In the Allen Bradley PLCs, these are the three jump instructions: jump to subroutine, subroutine, and the return instructions. Okay. The subroutine instructions are summarized like this. So here you all can see in this figure, this is JSR, jump to subroutine. This is the file number U:3. This will jump to the file or the subroutine which is having the label U:3 or the address with the U:3. Then SBR, this is the subroutine, like how we explained here. This is a subroutine area, SBR, right? This is called as SBR. Then return is this last instruction in the subroutine. Okay. Then subroutine, it is the input instruction. Here we are using it near the end rung. If we are using near the end rung, it is output instruction. If we are using near the starting rung, it is input instruction. This RET return instruction is used at the end rung. It is used at the end of the rung, so it is the output instruction. JSR and RET are the output instructions, whereas SBR is the input instruction. Clear here? The subroutine instructions are explained like this: JSR, jump to subroutine. The JSR instruction is an output instruction that causes the scan to jump to the program file designated in the instruction. It will jump from a particular instruction in the main program to the instruction which is given some label. We are giving some label to the target instruction, right? To that target instruction, the jump will take place. It is only the parameter entered in the instruction. When rung conditions are true for this output instruction, it causes the processor to jump to the targeted subroutine file. When the conditions become true, what will happen? The processor will jump from the main program instruction to the subroutine instruction. Each subroutine must have a unique file number. Every subroutine have the some label or the address or a file number. For example, from decimal 3 to decimal 255. That is the file number that is given for the subroutines. SBR instruction is the first input instruction on the first rung in the subroutine file. The subroutine program, SBR is the always first input instruction. It is always the first instruction in the, that is the subroutine file. In the subroutine program, SBR is the first instruction. What is the function of this SBR instruction? It is an identifier for that subroutine. It identifies which subroutine it is, right? It identifies which subroutine it is. That is the SBR instruction. This file number is used in the JSR instruction to identify the target to which the program should jump. This file number or the identifier or the subroutine address, it identifies the jump should take place to what instruction in the subroutine. To what instruction? To the first instruction in the subroutine, what is the label? What is the address? That is always mentioned in the JSR instruction. And as the JSR instruction executes, it will jump to that particular label of the first instruction in that subroutine. RET, return instruction, is an output instruction that marks the end of the subroutine file. RET instruction is always the last instruction in the subroutine. It causes a scan to return to the main program at the instruction following the JSR instruction where it exited the program. That's what I told. The return instruction is the last instruction. Once it executes the RET instruction, it will return back to the next instruction in the main program. Suppose the JMP instruction is executed, it will jump to subroutine, it will execute the SBR instruction, then second, third, fourth, and so on instructions in the subroutine. The last instruction is RET. When it executes RET, it will return back to the next instruction after the jump instruction in the main program. The jump to subroutine JSR, SBR, subroutine, and RET return are used to direct the controller to execute a subroutine 5. The next figure shows the material conveyor system with a flashing pilot light as a subroutine. As you all can see in this figure, there is a weight sensor here, there is a pilot light, a lamp, then there is a solenoid valve which is connected here, solenoid, right? As the weight is sensed by this, it will check for the particular weight of the fluid in this tank. When the weight reaches a particular value, that time the solenoid will be de-energized. Okay, let us see that. Then the pilot light will flash. The pilot light will flash. Let us see the working of this. Flashing pilot light subroutine, that is what is shown in the figure A. This is pilot subroutine process. And in the second figure, what we are seeing is the program for the flashing pilot light. This application is interesting. Here, let us say the sensor is closed. Okay, sensor is closed. That is, it senses a particular weight. Still, the weight has not reached the limit. So it closes the condition. Condition is closed here. This switch is closed. Then jump to subroutine. Yes, please.
Sir, there was an emergency. Can I please leave the class for some time?
No, I didn't get your point.
Sir, there was an emergency at my home. So I just wanted to leave the class. Can I, sir?
Yes, please. Yes, please. Sure, sure. By all means. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay.
Have a good time.
Okay, thank you. So students, here there is a switch being pressed. So as the switch is pressed here, the sensor is closed. When it reaches a particular weight in the liquid here, fluid reaches a particular weight, right? It has not reached the limit, so it is closed condition. As it is closed here, the JSR instruction will be activated. When the JSR instruction is activated, will jump from U colon 3. Where is U colon 3? It is here. It's a subroutine file 3. This will be executed. Okay. That is, there is a timer here. T4:1/done bit. It is initially open state because done bit is not high here for this timer. It is open. So condition is true. The timer, this starts functioning. Then once the accumulated value becomes equal to preset value, done bit is 1. T4:0 done. Then this T4:0 done is connected as input to the next timer. This will start to work and its value reaches from accumulated value to preset value and done bit becomes high. And this is not connected anywhere. The last instruction is return instruction. Return means where it will return. It will return to the next instruction after the jump instruction in the main program. This is our main program. This is a subroutine. Okay, there are two programs here. One is the main program. Another one is the subroutine. Okay, so it jumps from the return. Jump program means it will jump from the main program to the first instruction in the subroutine. Then as it executes the return instruction, it will return back to the second instruction, that is the next instruction after the jump instruction. So it is here the sensor. So it will sense the value of the sensor again. So if it is open, let us say now the weight has reached its limit. Okay. If the weight on the conveyor exceeds a preset value, the solenoid is de-energized. The weight on the conveyor exceeds a preset value, solenoid is de-energized and pilot PL1 will begin flashing. What is happening here? This sensor, this will be turned on. It is energized. It will become open because now the solenoid valve will be de-energized, right? So because of this, this condition becomes true and this pilot light, whatever is there, this starts to blink. Pilot light starts to blink. Okay. Because the weight of the fluid has reached a particular value. Then this T4:1/enable bit, this is also meant when it is T4:1, this enable bit is high here. This is also used to flash the pilot light. Then stop bit, it is normally closed. Start when it is closed here, then it is used to energize the motor. Then there is a sealing contact, this motor sealing contact, which is used to conduct the current even after the start switch is released. Then there is off on switch here. So off on switch when it is closed, when this sensor is open, this is different from this. Okay, don't think that this and this are same, right? This sensor is different. This is on off when this becomes true, and when this becomes true, your open condition, the solenoid valve will be activated. Solenoid is activated or it is energized. Okay, it's a small program which shows the jump from the main program to the subroutine and the return, which is the last instruction in the subroutine, which will cause the control to return to the next instruction of the jump instruction in the main program. Okay. I hope this diagram is clear to everyone. This ladder program is clear to everyone. In the examination, they may ask, write a ladder logic program for the flashing pilot light to instate the concept of subroutine. Right? Write a ladder logic program of the flashing pilot light to illustrate the concept of subroutine. You'll have to draw this ladder diagram to write it. Writing and drawing are same here. This is a program, so we use the word writing. It is not actually drawing. Okay, writing a ladder logic program. So it is a writing the ladder logic program. Okay. So is this program clear here, students? Understood this program? Yes, please. Any difficulty here in this program? Inoj? Inoj, any difficulty?
No, sir.
Okay, we'll proceed further. Next is nested subroutines. It's very simple. Concept is simple here. Nested means one subroutine within another subroutine. Here we are calling the subroutine. This is a main program file. Let us say we are using the jump instruction. From this jump instruction, it will jump to the subroutine. Okay, so this is a subroutine. In this subroutine, again there is a jump instruction within this subroutine itself. So it will jump from this subroutine to the next subroutine. Okay, then again in the second subroutine, there's one more jump instruction. It will execute this. And again, there is a jumping from second subroutine to some other subroutine, say third subroutine. After executing the third subroutine, the last instruction is RET, return. It will return to the next instruction in the main program. Now, which is the main program for this? Not this one. This is not the main program for this subroutine. Okay, this is the main program for this subroutine. Okay, please be very much clear about this. Then what will happen here? When it returns here, it will return to the next instruction after the jump instruction. That is, it will return to this instruction here. Then here, when it executes the return instruction in this, it will return to the next instruction after the JSR here, this instruction. Then when it executes the return instruction here, it will execute, it will come return to the next instruction after jump instruction. That is, it will return to this instruction. Such of the subroutines are called nested subroutines. That is, one subroutine inside the another subroutine. Okay. Nested subroutines allow you to direct program flow from the main program to a subroutine and then to another subroutine as shown in the figure. Nested subroutines make complex programming easier and program operation faster because the programmer does not have to continuously return from one subroutine to enter another. So it is one subroutine inside the another subroutine. It is called as nested loops. You might have studied in C language using one loop within another loop. If you are using if-else loop inside another if-else loop, it is called nested if-else loop. Similarly, in PLC language, it is nested subroutines. If you are using one subroutine inside another subroutine, it is called as nested subroutines. Next one is immediate input and immediate output instructions. So these immediate input and immediate output instructions, they are meant to indicate the status of the input at that particular instant of time. Suppose you want to check immediately what is the input condition in the image file. In the image file, input image file, table file, what is the condition of the input you want to check at that particular instant. At that particular instant only you want to check it. So you can do that using the immediate input instruction. Similarly, if you want to send the status of the your output image table file to the real world, to the field device, you can do that. Immediately you can send the output, whatever is there at that particular instant of the image table file, you can send it to the field device. Okay, so this such of the instructions are called immediate input and immediate output instructions. The name itself will tell you what is the meaning of immediate input. Okay, the immediate input and immediate output instructions interrupt the normal program scan. They will interrupt the normal program scanning process to update the input image table file. Update the input image table file means whatever is the status of the input, that will be reflected in the input image table file bits. Okay, if the input status is 1, 1 will be stored in the input image table file, that particular bit location. Right, similarly for the output, if the output image table file bit location is 1, then that 1 will be sent to the field device. It will be sent to the field device. Okay, with current input data, or to update an output module group with the current output image table file data. The immediate input Allen Bradley PLC 5 instruction is used to read an input condition before the IO update is performed. That means immediately, suppose you are executing the ladder run, immediately at that particular instant you want to check what is the input status, right? You can read it into the input image table file. Then that is the receiving. Then for the output, immediate output instruction, whatever the status of the output image table file, that you can send it to the output. Okay, this operation interrupts the program scan when it is executed. After the immediate input instruction is executed, normal program scan resumes. We can see in this figure the illustration of immediate input instruction. This is the normal scanning process of the program. IO scan is taking place, and when we are using the immediate input instruction, it interrupts the program scanning process, right? There is a interruption here of the normal program scan, and it examines bits in the word, that is I:012 here in the program. That means what it is doing is examining, means whatever is the status of this input, that it is going to store in the input image table file at this particular instant of time. Okay, that is, it is storing in the model group. This is the input rack number 1 returns, then it is storing in the rack number 1 0 1 1 2. Okay, there is a rack number, and the that is the slot number in that particular region or the area of the input image table file, it is going to store the bit. Then after that, it will return the return to the program scan. Okay, in the main program, and again it will continue. Right, this is the figure which shows the immediate input instruction. Okay, so this is how it is used, IIN. This is immediate input instruction, IIN. Its address is 12. Okay, is this figure clear here? Any doubts in this figure, Mudabbira?
No, sir.
Okay, similarly we have the immediate output instruction. Next, the operation of the immediate input instruction is shown there. I have explained that already, how it is updated, right? When the scan reaches the true IIN instruction, the scan is interrupted. The processor updates 16 bits in the input image table at the location indicated in on the IIN instruction. The two-digit address on the IIN instruction is composed of the rack number, first digit, and the IO group number, that is the second digit. So first digit indicates the rack number, and the second digit indicates the group number, input output group number, containing the input or inputs and needs immediate updating. The immediate output Allen Bradley PLC 5 instruction is a special version of the output energized instruction. Let us see the working of this with the figure. Here the IO scan is taking place, the output scanning is taking place, program scanning, and there is immediate output instruction here at this particular juncture. Okay, as there is an immediate output instruction, the scanning is taking place, there is interruption in the scanning process, the IO scanning process. Then whatever is the status of the this output image table file, that will be sent to the output. That will be sent to the output, or it is used to control the field devices. Okay, then it, after this scanning, immediate output instruction is executed, and it sends the status of the output image table file to the output device or to the field device, then it will return back to the main program, and it will start continuing the scanning process of the main program or the scanning process of the program. Okay, this is how the immediate output instruction works here. Right? Any doubts in the students? Immediate output instruction and any questions here? Saval, any questions? Saval, Inoch, any questions on this? Inoch?
No, sir.
Okay. I'll just explain in brief once again. Immediate output instruction. It's a special version of the output energized instruction used to update the status of output device before the I/O update is performed. At that particular juncture itself, it will update the output. When the program scan reaches the immediate output instruction, the scan is interrupted and the bits of the addressed word are updated. The operation of the immediate output instruction is explained in the following figure. That is, when the program scan reaches a true IOT instruction, IOT means immediate output, the scan is interrupted and the data in the output image table at the word address on the instruction are transferred to the real world outputs. Look at this statement. The data in the output image table at the word address on the instruction are transferred to the real world output. That means whatever data is there, the output image table file, that will be sent to the output devices. In this example, the IOT instruction follows the output energized instruction. Thus, the output image table word is updated first and then the data are transferred to the real world outputs. What is happening here is, first this table will be updated and then whatever data is stored in this table, that will be sent to the output device or the field devices. Okay. In today's class, students, we have covered starting from the program control instructions, that is master control reset instruction, then various types of program control instructions, jump, LBL, label, jump to subroutine, return, subroutine, temporary end, master control reset, and suspend. Okay. Then we have hardwired master control relay, which is similar to the master control reset instruction. We have seen the working of the master control reset instruction by considering this ladder logic program. Then later we have seen what is meant by a zone of MCR, what is meant by zone, what happens when the zone is true and what happens when the zone is false. Then what is a jump instruction, the definition of jump instruction. Then we have analyzed the program, or we have seen the working of the jump instruction by considering this particular ladder program. We have jump to label from two locations, right, which is jumping to the same label. What is a subroutine? Its definition of the subroutine. Then main program with a call from a subroutine, right, it is jumping from here to subroutine, and return means it will return back to the next instruction after the jump instruction in the main program. Then various subroutine instructions, that is JSR, then we have SBR subroutine and RET return. JSR and RET are output instructions, whereas SBR is used at the input side of the ladder rung. It is input instruction. We have also gone through the flashing light program to illustrate the concept of subroutine, the flashing of the pilot light when the weight sensor reaches a particular level. When the weight of the fluid here in the tank reaches a particular level, the weight sensor is, that is activated, and then the Soulard valve is de-energized, because of which the pilot light will start to flash. This is the ladder program that we have written for the flashing pilot light subroutine. Then what are nested subroutines? That is, subroutine within another subroutine is called a nested subroutine. Then we have seen the immediate input and output instructions. In examination, the possible question on this topic may be, explain the immediate input and immediate output instructions with necessary figures. You will have to draw these figures, whatever are there, and then explain the immediate input and immediate output instructions. Okay. So these are the immediate input and immediate output instruction points on this topic. We have seen them by looking at the figures for the immediate input and immediate output instructions. Okay, so in the next class, students, I'll be continuing with the immediate input and input output instructions. Some portion is remaining, and then we'll consider the other topics, that is other instructions. And then maybe there's a temporary end instruction, then suspend instruction. All those we'll take up in the next class. Okay. Tomorrow, shall we have one class from 8:30, students? 8:30, is it okay for you all? 8:30 to 9:30. Inoj. Inoj.
Sir.
Yes, sir, please.
Sir, you what? Should ask group, sir.
Okay, I'll put the message in the group then.
Yes, sir. Because again, if tomorrow they don't attend, it will be waste.
Yes, yes, that is true. I understand. Yes. So I'll put in the group then. If there are any views, let them put their views in the group so that I will come to know. Is it okay now, Inoj? Inoj?
Yes, ask them in the group.
Okay, fine. Yes, sir. So I'll understood that today's topics clear, right? What all we discussed? Inoj? Inoj, is it clear today's topics? Mudabbira?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay. Then we'll continue in the next class, right? Thank you.